The Ofsted report of children's social care in Barnet is an accurate reflection of our services at this time. And as Director of Children's Services, I am ultimately accountable for the provision of quality of those services. I unreservedly apologise to children and people in Barnet who have not received timely, high-quality services. It is vital that we increase the pace of our improvement work, and that is our focus going forward. We're looking forward to working both with Ofsted and the Department for Education to ensure that we continue to strive to fulfil our vision to be the most friendly borough in London by 2020. I'm happy to take any questions, and colleagues are happy to take any questions on the substantive items in relation to the report, and so I'm not planning to say any more to the report.
Councillor Hart.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. Mr. Munley, you mentioned just now the pace of improvement required. Page 19 of this report refers to the additional £5.7 million approved by the PR committee. What are you proposing to do with this funding? And are you personally satisfied that these measures will adequately improve the practice?
I will ask colleagues to talk about some of the specific work that we're going to undertake with the elements of funding that are around improvement. The £5.7 million that's referred to also has a significant amount of money associated with increased demand pressures within the service, both in relation to demographics, but also with changes in relation to the development of the 025 service, which is a service for children and young people and adults with disabilities. I am confident that, subject to a range of different issues, i.e. that we can continue to recruit high-quality social workers, that we don't lose lots of staff because of the judgments, that we have a plan that we are bringing to you today that can address the concerns that Ofsted had. I think the investment is for a range of different things, ranging from youth violence and missing youth homelessness, but also specific additional resource for children care around their work on missing, life story work and so on, but also, and this is the significant investment, is on practice improvement and quality staffing to be able to drive improvements in social work practice. But I'll ask my colleagues to just give you a little bit more detail of what that will look like.
So we're going to be embedding, I mean, if you look at the recommendations from the report, most of the majority, 14 out of 19, are about the quality of social work practice. So what we have to do is focus our efforts on improving the quality of practice. And to do that, we need staff to be close to practice, people who know what good social work looks like, to be supporting them. We need to quality assure their work, and we need to make sure they get the right training to develop the skills they need deliver good social work. So the investment is going on quality assurance officers, it's going on practice development workers, it's going on a redesigned workforce development arrangement and set of programmes, because all of our efforts seem to focus on what social workers are doing and have the quality of the management oversight that oversees the quality of that practice. So that's the majority of that money that's going into those posts. To at the end, or we can, you can note it now, we can do it at the end,
move an additional recommendation at some stage, because we do know now that only this week another London borough has had a similar inspection and he's had a good rating and outstanding leadership. And I think it would benefit both the lead member and I'd like to go as well to actually visit this council and actually see what we can learn from what they've got to offer us as to how they've achieved that rating. So that's just a flag up as additional recommendation and to move to full council. But there are so many questions I think that we need to ask, and a lot of it goes back to the reorganisation as to when we lost a middle tier of management and we had a whole raft of social workers that left the authority, and we had a whole host of agency social workers working within the authority, which we had to do because we had to fill the post, which was necessarily more expensive but far less easy to be able to track and monitor the quality of the work, because as you know, whether it's temporary teachers or temporary social workers, they come and go as and when you need them. And how that impacts on the continuity, and again, the drift that we have and the lack of reporting and the robustness of the service, it leads to an awful lot of questions. And then when you think back to why the committees are all receiving different pieces of information that don't seem to link up, so that we're not all as well informed as we need to be, I think there's an awful lot of work to do from here on in to make sure not only that the officers can take this work forward, which I'm sure they're obviously doing with the best intentions to try and get the best possible and the good result, but also to make sure that we as members have got the right information at the right time to be able to challenge at the right time. And if we're not getting the information as a matter of course, then we're not being able to challenge it if we're not being given the information. So I'll leave it at that for now, but I think we should send more to come.
Thank you. I was trying to comment on the item you referred to, the green, the item we have at the end of the paper, which I think does need to be touched on. So two political points that you raised there. I fully agree and intend to defer this to the full council, but I think we need to have, as we extended, an opportunity to focus with this in this committee before we do that, because in full council we don't get anything like the time to be able to give consent that we need to as members this evening. And on the second item, I'm not sure I know precisely which borough you're referring to, but I'm more than happy to visit a borough that just had an offset outcome that's different from ours. There's always learning that we can take from every visit that takes place, whether it's going there or reading the report, but actually to learn a lot more from the people. So I'm more than happy to do that.
I'm sure I'm not sure. Given that they've just had theirs released, chances are they might even have the same team, I don't know. But the point is, they certainly have a good report, outstanding leadership, so I think it's not a long way to go. We should take the initiative and go and visit them and see what we can learn from them.
Certainly, we're always keen to learn from the authorities. It's Islington for members of the public that is being referred to. We are working as well with Essex, who are a good authority in relation to social care. That's who've been working with us for a period of time. The challenge for us in terms of working with partners is finding partners who've had a similar journey to us, where there's been a need for transformational change. A number of authorities have had good social work services for many years and continue to have those services. We were in a situation 2 years ago where when I arrived, where that wasn't the case, and we needed people who had experience of driving substantial change in periods of time. I'm often speaking to the DCS in Islington. She's already spoken to me, or she's already alerted me to their report, and if there's any help that they can offer, we speak regularly and we will continue to do that. And I'm more than happy to arrange sessions to talk to them about some of the things they do. One of the things they do have is a much more robust quality assurance mechanism, which is one of the things that we are seeking to develop. In terms of the comments about information, and I agree with you, and one of the things that the report says is that we have now got to a point where our data is accurate because of the changes that we've made to the IT system. We were in a situation where not all information is being shared with members historically, and certainly at corporate parenting, we are doing that. I think one of the real challenges for us is that the framework now is very much about the quality of practice. It's not just about indicators. So if you look at our indicators in terms of caregivers, we are in touch with probably more caregivers than most authorities. They are in good housing. Their educational needs are being met. That will all be very green indicators in terms of those data sources. The quality of placement, the quality of pathway plans is something that is more difficult to be able to produce as a qualitative indicator. But we need to think about how we can best inform members of this life. So a challenge to Mr. Brown today for us to have some more narrative information, for example, on children missing from care, for parenting advisory panel, to enable members to see the more granularity of that issue, so that you can see which children are missing, how long they've been missing for, any issues that are going on in relation to those children, so that you have far greater clarity in relation to that. So I absolutely accept that some of the information that's collected is green, but that doesn't particularly relate to the quality of practice.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you, Gemma. I just wanted to briefly return to your physical point around performance information going to different committees. I thought I just wanted to reiterate, and I think we're very clear that information in respect of the Office of Improvement Plan and everything to do with the work we are doing to improve will come through the sales. There will be performance information quarterly going through to Performance Contract Management Committee as it typically will. But I think we're very, very clear that all the necessary information that enables you to properly scrutinise what is going on will come through this committee. I know you asked, as we set up the committee system, we had some of those discussions around what information will work. But I think it's worth us saying we're very, very clear that all necessary information comes here to enable the committee to properly scrutinise.
Thank you. Before Councillor Perry to ask the next question, I should have noted there's a typo on the front page of the paper suggesting that this is not a key item for the year's key item. It was there in the work program. That does mean that we'll certainly be able to refer Councillor Perry.
Through you, Chair, Mandy, how are you proposing to attract and recruit high quality social workers without grading and being able to?
I think that's one of the most challenges that we need to think about. Certainly, I'm going to ask Ms. Kerber to cover some of the issues that she's going to lead the workforce. We are working very closely with colleagues to try and ensure that we continue to recruit staff. We are in a stronger position than we were in terms of our agency rates have reduced dramatically over the last year, but there is still more to do, and we still need to consider a new type of approach. We need to think about how we invite people to come and work with us and work on our improvement journey. It needs to be a very different type of messaging. We also need to look at how we work with our people who are our student social workers who want to grow within the service and how we support them. I'll ask Ms. Gerber to clarify some of the other things that we're trying to do.
It's difficult when you've got the administration to attract people without having a launch where you rebrand. So we do need to rebrand and say, it's about bringing people along on our journey. We know we have a journey to. We need to invite people to be part of that, and you can attract interest from social workers in the field that are interested in being part of improvement work. But growing your own is a tried and tested way of getting a good calibre of staff, having a good workforce development programme around them, good management rates, opportunities for career development, enables you to retain those staff. I mean, Barnet's an outer borough, inner London borough, if you know what I mean. The best social workers often end up in the inner borough, inner London boroughs. Trying to get them to come out further afield, especially when you have such a big sort of like area to cover, it's more difficult because people travelling here isn't so easy, and the cost of living here isn't so cheap. So those things do affect
proof, but we do need to find ways to attract staff, you know, with good rewards for being here, good opportunities for them to develop, and good workforce development programs around them. But we'll want them to come and stay here and work here.
We should have to that.
Thank you.
I will take Councillor Hunt's question next, but I have a question for Councillor Perry. Is that practice leadership, how to ensure that this practice leadership is able to come to provide our first experience?
Well, Bridget and I both come from a local authority that was inspected last year, that got a good rating. We've been in local authorities that have been struggling previously and been part of their transformation work. So we know how much work it takes to turn the borough around and to get that practice up and running. So I'm confident in our capacity to be able to do that because we've done it before. But also, you know, we have a really clear programme, and I think the Ofsted report alludes to some of that work that's starting to emerge more recently, which has been the culmination of our efforts since October, of driving up the change that we want to see in the system. It does take time, but Ofsted did see it, and they recognised that there's many references to the recent improvements that they could see, but they're not yet embedded, they're not yet consistent, and that's what we need to work towards.
Thank you. Yes, I take on board what Sean was saying about the reports coming to this committee, and I understand that, and I think that's also quite right. What I'm thinking behind all that, it's about us on this committee in particular being aware of what goes to other committees, so how we can get over, for example, the performance indicators go to PCM, okay, they aren't everything, they're looking at quality, not just the PR, I understand that. But there's corporate parenting, some domestic violence went to community leadership, policy and resources get stuff. I think maybe that's not a debate possibly for tonight here, but I do want to flag it up that I think we need to look better at how we better, particularly for this committee, though, and it may affect other committees, but particularly for this committee, and there are so many bits of information going to other committees, that we do need to try and see if we can get a robust system of connection between what goes to the different committees. But what goes to the different committees? So we get an email, or we get perhaps reports, or something. I know that governors don't like saying report goes to more than one committee, and I understand that. But somehow we need to get over the fact so that we have, just so that we on this committee have a better handle on what's going on across the board. Not if it goes down here. I think it's here.
Yeah, I mean, thank you. I suppose to respond to that, clearly there is more work to do, and you know, we can take some of that away. And one of the things that I was reflecting, perhaps going back to what Mr. Munday was saying around performance data and quality data not always matching up. Now, in an ideal world, actually, the two should be the same thing. So ideally, actually, our indicators that are going to performance contract management will not just be sort of measuring outputs, they will be measuring quality as well. But ultimately, what we're trying to achieve in our corporate plan is good quality service, and that's the same thing that this improvement plan is also driving. So I think the challenge for us, yes, is to make sure you have oversight of all the different information, but actually, no matter where this is being reported, whether something's going to the performance committee or it's going here, it really ought to be looking at the same thing, which is quality of service. I think, you know, so there's something for us to do to make sure those two things are the same.
I may just give a particular way of describing it. We do not support it as Facebook, and that's a key approach to driving quality. And we can report that those requirements, and we have historically reported them in November 15 when we were identifying that there's still significant problems in the service. The difficulty we have is if we then put a target around improvement. Because what we want is audit to be a pure process where there's not in the back of the minds of managers that actually the results need to go up. It needs to be that it's truly reflecting the practice. So we need to think about a way that if we're reporting audit findings, so whether case files are outstanding, good, whether the work requires improvement or whether it's inadequate,
We need to maintain the purity of that system and not start putting targets to it. And that's the dilemma that we're in terms of reporting information. Because it would be very easy for me to say, well, actually, I want 100% of audits to be good or outstanding. No authority has that, not even the best authorities achieve that. Those are some of the dilemmas that we need to think through as we report things. It's also about, as I was saying, about children missing from care. Actually, how do we report that in a way that informs members appropriately, enables them to appropriately challenge, without creating a system that means that we falsely report improvement because we want, in the back of our minds, to be getting better.
Thank you, Chair. I think we all realise there is a problem with the flow of information between both parent panel cells, PCN, but also between other committees. We did a massive project from the Committee Leadership Committee on the strategy of violence against women and girls. And I think all members of the council were invited to contribute to our elements of that. With the example of actually working outside of the committee structure, even though we're in the committee structure. And I think there's elements in there, maybe it was Mr. Google, but we've finally signed up, there's elements within that strategy that will have impact on other committee areas, and I think it needs to be reported back to those committees and responsibility in it. Obviously, this report, you know, there's a lot of that strategy which will reflect on how we take this particular area forward, and I think we should be working in silos, we need to be working a lot wider. My concern with performing indicators a bit like me, when it's a demand-led service, putting a tick box and an achievement on it is very difficult to measure. I always sometimes think that performance indicators, not just here, actually don't reflect what we want to see as councillors, the measurement we want to see. You know, basically, we give that pace for on a daily basis. I think it needs to be how we revisit that. Where the councillors can put into what we want to see from this particular service area, what we want to see challenged and measured. I think it's clear. And I think on that particular thing, I think we're all continuing from the same initiation. I would think about recruitment. Social workers talk to each other. They're aware. Yeah, they meet a lot. So they're aware of, you know, past the recruitment problems, it has been that, and a lot of people. Some of the good people who may have considered coming to Barnet might not have, which has also exacerbated the situation we found ourselves in. Obviously, clearly, the evening has been restructuring the children's services in 2014. The paper was finally signed in September 2014, but it doesn't actually mention any figures in it. So basically, there's no relation to proposing the budget for that year to remove a tier of management in children's services. The Ofsted report comments that the structure is wholly unsuccessful in achieving a positive social work service for children. Unsurprisingly, the structure of the demands are being stretched more thinly, and a lot of staff are leaving, taking corporate memory away with them and expertise. When you lose social work, those children have lost their expertise, families have lost that expertise in them. So clearly there is an issue. What risks were discussed internally with the administration of the proposals for that restructuring in 2014 were taking place. I mean, it just seems ignorant. Surely they must. What was the risk assessment? What was the risk management when such a chunk of money was taken out of such a vital service? I don't know what discussions were actually taking place. So I think one thing we really need to, concern is clearly the rating services of the statement has suffered and then reported is deteriorating practice standards. So the responsibility as cabinet member and as chair of this committee, what responsibility are you taking for this chair? Because it is a responsibility to take on behalf of our members. If the risks weren't flagged up to you, why weren't they? If they were, what did you do about it? I think that is one of my biggest concerns on that, because basically there's a failing somewhere, and heads should roll. People lose their jobs if they make mistakes, and I think I must be probably What I don't also want to do is coming back again to the court, because it will come back regularly to the committee. Having, again, the report just to be noted, I think there needs to be opportunity when it does come back, reports that members can actually make recommendations to it if it feels it's necessary. The report to be noted, the table of contingencies, I don't think what anyone on this committee wants. We want to see such an infinite campus service go forward positively. I think that's for now. Some of the questions could be related, but at item 9, similar questions, I don't think they can give different reports, because it's quite a heavy report to go through. So some of the other questions I have around the CPI will probably come on item 9.
Councillor Burke, I will respond to some of those points. I think Ms. Conde might have a few remarks as well. With respect to the former position where I was a cabinet member rather than as being chairman of the committee, I think it's really helpful that you point out the distinction between the two. And I think the comments that have been made by some members on your side have been very helpful in pointing out that there have been some challenges with the system. But one of the big advantages that we do have with the system is it allows us to have this level of scrutiny that we can actually see precisely what's going on, and we can dig down and get that level of detail. I completely agree with you that when we have items being brought back regularly for the sales committee to, I think, should be for approval, not for noting, in terms of the work that's being undertaken. I think we need to get information coming back, but we need to actually be in the driving seat to make decisions about it as well.
I'm happy to make sure that the reports that come as an update on our actions in relation to the OSCE report are absolutely for approval, for debate, for input, and you know, I want to enable that to happen more for members. And also, I would like to remind members, I will circulate again some of the work that has been done on the key questions that you should be asking. We circulated them in 2015 and 2016. I think we need to circulate again about how you can ask particular questions about both corporate parenting roles and safeguarding roles. I think there is also a need to look at how this committee we train more around some of the things that you might want to ask. In terms of 2014, I wasn't involved in any of the decision making. And so I can't particularly comment on that. All I can say is that when I, as Councillor Thompson stated in his initial comments, I identified a number of problems when I first arrived, and we have been trying to address those. I think it is important that, you know, we look at where we are now and how we move forward from now. I absolutely understand that there are critical issues around why this has happened, but we are now a period of time away from that, those decisions, and we need to look at what do we need to do now to improve the quality of service that we have. And as I said earlier, I take responsibility for the quality of service as it is at this present time, and I would continue. But I brought in, I'm very clear that we will need to make a significant improvement and headway over the next year and a half. The usual position in terms of re-inspection is around 2 years. So I can't answer the question in relation to 2014, but what I can say is that I'm really committed to drive forward from 2017 with the report that we've got, with the key areas that we need to drive forward, which, as Mr. Gavin said earlier, 14 of the 19 recommendations are about policy of practice. There are also recommendations around homelessness, around missing from care, but we also need to be addressing them. We are committed as a leadership team, and I know Mr. Hooton has been offering significant support into this area as well, as have Essex, who continue to be our improvement partner, driving some of that. So I think it's about how we move forward overall.
Sorry.
Just
a little bit, but I was only saying we probably realistically not to say something, clearly I was in the council at the time, a few years ago, clearly I was in a different role, and I think it's worth saying assurance we've given at the time that we
structure would be successful and have an impact on quality. And of course, in implementation, that clearly wasn't the case. And some of the points that Mr. Munday raised in terms of some of the bodies that were coming into the service and some of the problems that emerged, clearly that wasn't the case. But I mean, I think, you know, from my perspective, I was in a different role at the time, but clearly that assurance was there that restructuring would be successful. And we didn't have to do that in that way. Thank you. So,
thank you, Mr. Chairman. This is one now. I think the members of this committee don't want to leave it to a tick-boxing exercise in the future, but we really want to be involved and monitoring the progress that I'm sure people are going to make. And I wonder if perhaps we need an additional recommendation to recommendations tonight, in that something along these lines that the service committee at each meeting receives a full report, perhaps concentrating on just one aspect of the improvement plan and the suggestions from Ofsted, instead of just having a whole, as I said, a tick-boxing exercise, yes, we're doing this, but actually looking in depth and how that is progressing.
I have a recommendation at number 6 is that we agree that CELS had a standing item on progressing the implementation of the improvement plan. I'm happy to offer opportunity to do deep dives into particular areas if that would be helpful for members. And we could theme that through the meetings. I think what I would be loath to do with 19 recommendations is to look at one or two recommendations each meeting, because it won't suffice in terms of your challenge to myself and the leadership team that we're working on. But I think if there are particular issues that members want to deep dive, we could use either parenting and Mr. Adam looked after children's group, or we can use CELS to actually undertake that more rigorous look at particular issues. I think that there are a number of issues that would fit comfortably with that type of approach, and we can certainly make some proposals to you about how we could look at things over the next meeting, and we can then timetable them in. The really critical thing, though, is in the issue of a drift and delay, that we're tackling all of this at one go, and so we will be reporting everything, but there might be some things that would comfortably fit with you looking in more depth.
Thank you, Mr.
Chairman.
Councillor Hart, would you like to propose a formal recommendation to amend the recommendation 6 to include
discuss with my colleagues in legal, but we could add after the legal and say including deep dives as appropriate into areas of concern. One of the things that I asked Ms. Gary to look at when she arrived was our present situation in terms of young people who are homeless. This isn't young people who were in the care system. This is young people who report themselves to be homeless. We have very small numbers, but actually our provision was not strong. We didn't place any children in bed and breakfast, but we were placing children on their own studio flats. Mufagao has been working with a range of partners to develop a new approach, and I'll ask it to brief members on what that means, and that this is now live now.
Yeah, so we've been working as a partnership with housing and our early health provision, particularly the youth service, and early health provision around the common assessment framework that we have. We've developed a new protocol, a new joint protocol for 16, 17 year olds who present as homeless. What it ensures that they have is a good assessment of their needs. If they can go home, support should go home with them, but they shouldn't just be expected to go home, that there should be a wraparound for those young people from the youth service or from the family support service, because there's a reason they're presented in the first place, and I should address that. If they do come in and they need to be assessed for homelessness, we need to put them in safe, supported accommodation. They're still children. They need to be looked after, they need to have support around them, they're not ready to live independently. We've commissioned an approved provider list of providers that provide 24-hour wraparound support for those young people, and those placements for those young people will be commissioned through our placements team internally. So we won't be using temporary accommodation options for those young people. There's a number of young people in the borough who present as homeless, because they need to be out of the borough because they're involved in gang activity. They present a particular challenge, but what we've done is we've worked with some local authorities for our commissioning arrangements, and we've agreed that those young people can go to support accommodation in those areas. So we've agreed shared bed spaces, so they can use ours, we can use theirs, but the overlying principle is that they don't go anywhere, but they don't get a wraparound support. If they come in and they choose not to be a looked after child because they have the right to make those choices, they will get a child in need plan, and they will have a social worker coordinating that plan and supporting them until they reach adulthood, as we should be doing. So that's all in our new protocol. We've just signed it off. It will be going to the safeguarding board for final sign off, but that's not stopped us from implementing it immediately. So it seems that we've started for it. So it's live.
Do you want to follow up?
Yes, I was just going to ask, you said you'd produce a comment about another borough. Is that something that you've seen work well in other boroughs that other boroughs already do?
Yeah, this is in the last voice authority that I've worked in and many others that I've worked around partnerships with. You have to treat them as children. They are still children. They're under 18, they are children. And it has to be a respectful service that listens to what they have to say and preserves their presenting. There's a lot of research, there's a lot of legislation, there's a lot of statutory guidance around this particular group of young people. Their vulnerabilities to exploitation, scams, and to mental health problems and pathways into criminal justice are well researched. So we have to take care of them, and we should, and we will.
One thing that also really concerns me is about the local safeguarding board, where it says the lack of challenge has not been assisted in raising safeguarding challenges in the local authority. So I get the impression that there's an awful lot of people on there that maybe there is not the coordination and people attending the meetings that there should be. I know we brought up a while back, if I remember rightly, that there was a question that the police were not putting the right amount of money into the pot going wide that they should do, so whether it's just them or other aspects that are not pulling their weight in that respect. But in terms of the council as a whole, I mean, we are all corporate parents. That was why the pledge came forward. That is what we have got to take total responsibility for. But yourself, Councillor Johnstone, as lead member, you're the only one that's got the statutory responsibility. So do you think that you can? carried out that responsibility, but you were aware that there was this problem, that they were not raising the standards the way they should have been. And how do you think there's going to be the way forward on that one? I know also that in terms of what Ofsted said about leadership, and that we got the extra corporate support and resources, which I think translates more into money than anything else, but they're saying that this has been an effective improvement in standards of poor social work practice for children. So is that because that is a work in progress? And then we come back to the corporate parenting panel, which it also says has not received full performance information, which limits its ability to challenge any deficits in services effectively, which is what we talked about earlier, of not feeling that we're getting the right information. So, I mean, that's a host of questions about the safeguarding of your own role, the leadership thing, and the corporate support, is it actually making the impact, and also about the parenting panel, corporate parenting panel not getting, apparently, enough information to be effective, is how that's going to be addressed.
Thank you. At the start, it would be clear to me, in conversation with Mr. Mundo, that we identified the worst weaknesses that need to go on improvement, and as outlined in the Office of Support, significant progress has been made, but it's not far enough yet, and it certainly does need to continue at a pace.
I'm saying, but how did we as councillors and councillors as a whole, when did we know that the local safeguarding children's board was apparently not up to scratch? Because I don't
remember
being told.
We've been told to Ofsted.
But I'm saying, but prior to that, we didn't know. But I'm saying, did you know prior to Ofsted or not?
Did I know?
Did you know prior to the Ofsted report, given that you're the main sort of person on the council that's responsible for that safeguarding, that's your responsibilities, did you know before Ofsted that this was a problem?
These members of the Labour Group and I have had this on the Safe Family Children Board, and we've been a part of that journey, and I'm sure we've had a lot of challenging certain aspects of the Unsafe Family Board that we may well like to see done differently, but also there's a lot of work that's taking place there. Ofsted have been very clear and they should be able to make the assessments that actually there are serious inadequacies, and I think it does actually ask the wider question of what do we actually need from our partners to help us to actually carry on with this journey.
I think I know that requested the review be issued prior to Ofsted in relation to safeguarding. So we had a very clear picture in relation to some of the particular issues that was worked very recently. We are in the process of reconfiguring the safeguarding board in the light of that review. I also the light of Ofsted in fact this morning. In fact, we've done stay up in the safeguarding board looking at a range of different issues to make it stronger. I think one of the interesting issues here is this issue of challenge across the system and how we can move challenge from being seen as blame to being seen as a way of improving practice. And that's something that we've got to work on across the partnership as a whole, and also across our own services. In relation to the information that you referred to in terms of parenting panel, it also does say that the DCS has incrementally addressed this gap over the last few months. So you are now getting the same report that I get in relation to corporate parenting information. What I'm suggesting into the future is that we will give you even more information that I'm going to be commissioning in terms of the scene. Young people, I think that that's something that specifically needs to be addressed. But I don't know whether Mr. Hoop might want to say something about how he's been, as the chief executive accountant for the safeguarding board, how he has been looking at how we improve those relations.
Thank you. Yeah, I mean, it's very exactly rather than reiterate everything that he's just said. Commission the review at the beginning of this year into the effectiveness of the safeguarding board due to some of the legislative change that is coming through. Safeguarding boards may change in the future, so part of the review is the sort of effectiveness of the board, part of the review is also a look to the future in terms of what arrangements we might have in the future. The review was commissioned at the beginning of the year and actually completed around about April time, around about the time it obviously came in. know that losses were coming in. So, that report has been very useful. I mean, there are a number of recommendations just around around the remit of the board, the makeup of the board, making sure we've got the right people involved. I'd actively having discussions with Chair and Chief Officer of the CCG, with the Borough Commander, to make sure that police and health and ourselves are all around the table at strategic level, making sure we're taking that seriously. Part of that has been around, you mentioned funding, so part of that has been around saying we need to adequately fund the board, and that involves contributions from health, contributions from police, as well as the local authority. That will enable us to do more work around things like multi-agency audit. It will also enable us to do more around training and development, and making sure that the OSCB can properly fulfil that role. So there are some very clear issues for us to address. I think we know what they are, and we're working as quickly as we can to make sure we.
Thank you, Mr.
Hirsch.
Thank you.
I'm pleased to hear about that restructure, and I know that's happening, and that's fine. It goes back to what I was saying earlier about sharing information on an interlinked basis of cost, and nothing else to be said about the board is also an issue in point, a case in point on. If you look on the website, it's very difficult to find minutes from the safeguarding board. And the last one was July 2016. Now, I know there have been proposals to change the quality of the system, and perhaps that has had an influence on it. But if we are to be able to be transparent with our information sharing, then I think we need to make sure that the information are supposed to be on the website, then they're up on the website. But if they're not, they're not. There should be another way of reporting that information. But at least we need to be clear across all these avenues of sharing information.
I'll say that way, and then we can see why there are those not in there. We were looking at bringing a report to September's meeting themselves, but we've also now got other reports that are going to be covering this issue off. So we have looked at quality assurance in relation to social care at this committee. We went through quite a detailed slide presentation in July. I note that issue there. We were doing it back in 2015. We've only recently, more recently introduced that.
It's really something that I'd like to know where you can actually get the information for the future, to where you think it would be best to go to, hoping it would come to here, is that one of the parts of the report reports as to what happened in other areas and about social workers relates to a report from a child in Hackney who had the same social worker for the 7 years that child needed a social worker. Now it's my belief that, and I should probably think rudely or not, that the more continuity you have with a social worker with the young person, the better the outcome. So is there any way that we can get information and can it be brought to sales to tell us, say, over the past year or whatever you think is appropriate, for the children that come in that require a social worker in terms of disturbance? you think how many changes impact on the service that that child receives. So I think this is uniformly saying that obviously the more continuity the better. But what I want to try and find out is, especially during the period where we have this whole flux of agents and the whole period of a load of our permanent staff leaving, as to how many changes did our young people have in terms of their social worker while this whole period of flux that resulted in this end result of inadequate, to actually get a proper personal picture as to how much this actually impacted on the young people.
Certainly we can produce that data. I think we do have a number of social workers that have remained employed by the local authority for a long period of time. And actually we do have data that shows that some young people have their social worker for substantial periods of time. I also think we need to make sure that we don't just assume that continuity of social work actually leads to better outcomes. It's about purpose of social work. It's about making sure that social workers are doing the right thing with our children and that they're intervening appropriately to support children to develop. But certainly we can give that information. I think what we need to think about is actually how we identify normal transition. So just like children going to different schools, children move through the social care system, and so you will move from being in the children care team to the aftercare team. And that would be a formal transition at a point in time. That we should be counting as a significant change in terms of social work. So we will look at how we can produce that data. But we can also give you information on how many social workers have been here for significant periods of time.
I think it's also because part of the report indicates about the voice of the child and life stories and all that aspect, is that I want to get a picture that from when 2014 to now, to when we had all this flux, to get this report, to now try and rectify it all, I'm trying to get an idea as to how much all that had an impact on the voice of the child, as to was the changes and the huge use of agency staff, how much did that actually impact on the quality of care that the children were receiving?
I think there are fundamental issues about this child. There's fundamental issues about how we, as a council, have developed our work in this area. The pledge is recent. There wasn't a pledge when I arrived, but actually gave any offer to children and young people. So, you know, what we've just reported on the first year of the pledge that sets out a range of indicators that say this is the difference that this is making. What is absolutely critical, and is one of our major weaknesses, is that when Ofsted were talking with social workers, they could sense that social workers knew the children very well. What they couldn't see was how that was recorded on the system and how they were using that information to develop their care plans. I'll ask colleagues to expand on that better, but that is what they particularly mean about the voice of the child making an impact on the plans. If we can't evidence that, that is a problem. And we've got to do more work on training staff to understand that these are the things that are absolutely critical.
One follow-up to that, which is also we mentioned when it's about the corporate parenting panel, where it says the panel processes do not support children to bring individual concerns or complaints to panel members' attention, and members do not have direct links with children. Neither do they routinely attend children in care meetings, so they're missing opportunities to gain insight into the life, experience, or concerns of the children in their care. So how are we going to remedy that aspect, we want?
Okay, how are we going to remedy that? There's a number of things that we need to do. The first thing that they picked up is our complaints leaflet. Everybody else on the complaints leaflet, but not their local member. So and it's really interesting if we have a complaints leaflet that is for children in care that talks about them going to their MP, but doesn't talk to them about these are members of the corporate parenting panel or corporate parenting champions or all their local councillor. So one of the things we've got to remedy is that our complaints leaflets need to reflect the fact that you have a
things that I want to explore with members at Corporate Preparative is how we can do this better, because there's also a significant challenge here in the fact that, you know, we don't want to always interfere with children and young people's lives. Sometimes at Corporate Parenting, when young people have come, there's been quite a lot of questions focused at young people that hasn't necessarily been as helpful as it could have been.
But they should be asking us, should be the right
one. That's not what's particularly happened, Councillor. So we need to think about how we do this in a way that is empowering for young people. Members are able to go to the Children Care Council. I know that Councillor Stock does this quite regularly. I know that Councillor Hutton has been to Woodhouse Road to do this. I know that Councillor Thompson has done. What we need to look at is for those members where they particularly have an interest in this area, that we're supporting them to do that. In terms of not interfering with the lives of our children and people. So I know that members quite like going to children's homes, but that's a particularly narrow focus, and we need to look at opportunities. What I would say, and I do ask that you forgive me in saying this, all members were invited to the celebration at Allianz Park, where we had over 100 young people in care celebrating and giving them awards. Two members came to us. And that, for me, is a really important thing. And we do need to think about actually how do we enable you to do that? And if there's an event like that,
Have it
just
fine when those people are working during the day
in
attendance.
It went into the evening. So the actual
event.
We can look at all of those things, but it's also about how we can get young people to the events. But it is about, we are offering those opportunities. If they're not the right type of opportunities, I'm happy to look at how we do that. But the really critical thing for me is that children and young people enjoy those events. And they do talk about that we do celebrate the achievements of young people. I really want members to be much more engaged with children and understand their issues. And I'm happy to work with you about how we do that better.
I think the conclusion is that the service we've had hasn't been user-friendly to anybody. It's been difficult for children, counsellors, to understand the issues that have been a problem. I think we talk about continuity. I think there is also continuity. It's also about, it's not just about the child, but families there and other family members who are affected, very much so. And I think there's a information. So you have a child under five and there's a domestic violence piece of called out, automatically goes, and a caseworker is assigned. Not? Why not?
Well, it depends. So every child that comes in contact with police, regardless of what circumstances that is, it generates a report to the police, yes, or to the public. And those Merlins are rated, red rated by the police, and then they're passed on to children and social care if their response is needed. All children under one automatically are seen by a social worker, but it's assessed in context. Mm-hmm. So just because the police have been called out doesn't necessarily mean harm has happened, but it is flagged. We do look at it, and we'll look at it in a context of what else is going on in that family, what else we might be concerned about, or where the particular strengths are, or if it's a particular argument that the neighbours heard or worried about, but it's not, people argue, it happens. So it's about understanding what that information means and what we need to do about it. I think children under one are the only group that always gets seen by a social worker.
But it's always, it tends to be children who are not in education, tends to be in areas like that, because once you start nursery school, you've got other adults who might flag up issues. But the other thing is about the continuity is that once a case has been assigned, there's about a couple of cases, things tend to go silent, and then either someone's in wrong, social services back up, and the caseworker assigned is no longer the caseworker, unless that person actually won Barnet Council. we want to know. So this is him just flagging that the different things in the system, it's about that information. If somebody's developed, I've had a case where I've had a few problems, blah, 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 and suddenly silence. And people think, well, what's the point? And I think there is actually, we need better user-friendly service for everyone.
So I suppose there's a couple of things that happen in the system, and the system doesn't help. So if they come into the match, or the entrance safeguarding part, they might speak to a social worker on the telephone, but that's not their case social worker.
But this is someone who's had a visit.
But they can be visited by the match social worker. So sometimes they get confused around who is their case worker. If they get passed for an assessment, they'll see an assessment social worker who's reading is trying to take an assessment. They won't be the social worker that's doing the plan for the child. So if there's a plan created, so they move, the child moves through the system as their needs develop or risk changes. It's only when they get to the end journey, corporate parenting, where a permanency plan is made for some children, obviously not all children, that probably end up in corporate parenting doing something very wrong, if that's the case. But it's, yeah, they're the only ones that get a long-term, a real long-term service. Everybody else comes in, we hope, or we intend to, work with them, improve what's happening in their lives, and we can move them out of the system again. They shouldn't be in the system long term.
Councillor Cornelius.
Yes, Councillor Lundy. You mentioned corporate parenting panels. A lot of members in Europe are very happy to go to the children's centres. How regularly, because I used to sit on corporate parenting with Councillor Hutton and we regularly used to go and visit. How regularly is that being done and reporting back to the corporate parenting panel?
I couldn't tell you off the top of my head, but I can look back in the corporate parenting minutes, but I know that there have been with some visits.
I would think it's going to be 4 to 6 members
being worked up.
I think what happened in practice, I think what happened, it was agreed in practice that would be one of our roles that we could ever do that. In theory, I mean, but in practice, it was left to us to organise to say, like, for example, I might say to Councillor Stoffer, should we go visit whichever home? And then it would happen, or more likely the other way around. One of them would say to me, and I'd say, yes, we need to be proactive, and we are not all as proactive as we need to be, so it might be better to have a rota. Since I've got the microphone, I'm going to say about the prize giving for the young people. I wasn't there, but I agree that we should go. But I don't think it's just a question of us going once a year to a prize giving. I think it needs to be more consistent across the board, and I'm guilty of that as well. But hopefully, from some of the discussions tonight, we will be able to be a bit more engaged with young people across the board across the year. Yes, go to prize giving at the end of the year, but not just like, you know, once a year ago and then.
We'll come back to you, Councillor. I want to come to your observations and respect that, because I think it's a very helpful point to make. There are different levels to which members do actually participate at the various events that take place. Some members do it a lot, and other members do it, I think, a little. And I think there's also a question, Mark, when we've spoken to officers on corporate parenting around visiting residential homes. There's certainly a value in having members visiting the home so that members are aware of what goes on there and so that they feel like that they get the representation that they deserve by having members come to actually see them. At the same time, we have to be aware that it's their home and that if we're regularly coming to see them, and one of the problems we have had with actually announced visits we were going to see them is it can be very difficult to young people because for some reason they're not there when we come to visit, which is quite understandable in a sense. So I think we need to be mindful that I'd be reticent to have a really, really rigorous programme that says we're going to have a visit every 2 months or 3 months or something, because I think that it could actually be too much for the young people who are in there. But I think it will be very helpful when we do report this, refer this item up, to actually raise this with other members who perhaps don't sit on corporate programme panel, that is something that they can go and visit, and that there are these events that Mr.
Monday and other officers do actually invite us to regularly, and now it's actually got the spotlight shining on it, unfortunately because of the report that we've got, because of the service that we actually have. It's an opportunity for us to raise that profile with other members across the entire council to take that opportunity and to think, how can they be more engaged and more involved with the young people that we have? That's what Kimberly is.
Yes, I was going to say, I think one of the most important things was that it is for councillors who might be actually working in town, that some of the young people actually felt they taught us in a really different way. And I know we always had to do it as pairs, but we did try to do it. And in fact, at one point when I was sitting on children's angle of parenting, the children's took visits to our older places. And corporate parenting did the younger or vice versa. And then it was left to corporate parenting too. But I know there was, as Councillor Hunt will remember, there were those who did the visits and those who had to be encouraged to do the visits or but I do think that was really valuable. And it's very good that the report seems to come to the committee and then whoever was doing the next visit could read the previous report and pick up on any comments of those two councillors who've been previously to make sure everything's sorted. Whether it was a gate that and then we can spin off things out of that, trying to teach them how to cook it. Surely that is part of being the corporate parenting, which is part of my
of that information regardless of whether they're in borough or out of borough.
I think certainly we can look at that, and that's what I'm saying on the leaflets. Actually, how do we make sure that people understand that we have a pack where children come into care, and we can make sure that that information includes details of local councillors on it. I think we do need to think about what training you have if you're going to be something that people have had very difficult experiences in their lives, and members should be trained in relation to that. But certainly it's something that we can look into. As I say, we can bring that back to the future meeting. I don't know, Mr. Ryan, in relation to what Craig has got the views on how members can be more involved.
This issue actually came up as the last court parenting advisory panel. We had a very recent conversation, and the voice of the child team is actually doing this work at the moment to explore with young people how would you best participate in meetings like this or at court parenting meeting, as well as what they would like to see from the council. And that is in preparation to come back to the Court Parenting Advisory Panel at the next meeting, because it was recognised by all of us that this is an area that probably was a bit more developed in the past, and we need to go back to that. So I think that it's very clear that there is actual willingness from the Council to be more involved. We've just got to create the correct opportunities. What we do see is we have well, certainly through inspection and through other events, we have a wonderful group of young people that have got very clear opinions and views. And we are listening to them and strengthening those conversations with them about what it means to communicate. We're also helping social workers use the Momo app so that they, and in terms of technology, that's a way that we could actually look at facilitating communication between the young person in care and the professional network around them, so that they have more access to the adults who are parenting them, and that's part of the ongoing work. I think that in terms of it's not just about children in care, it's about when they're moving to become care leavers, that they become care leavers at a very vulnerable age of 18, where we expect them to move into an adult world far quicker than perhaps other young people. So there's a lot of development work that we're doing as a whole system. And I think one of the things that we want to develop as part of the leadership is a whole systems approach, because I think one of the things that we see a lot of is that things are happening, it's much like communication we've spoken about, much like we don't know about, they happen independently of each other. So what we need to do and what we are hopefully bringing to the system is a whole system approach. So as the child moves through the whole journey through the system,
there's
a consistent approach to their needs and their care.
Thank you,
Michelle. Yes, I know we talked a lot about council involvement, and there also used to be council officer involvement, that each council officer was paid out to each officer as champion.
No, it doesn't work. But what we have done is we've established now the Friends of the Virtual School, which is doing work raising money for the virtual school to fund a range of different activities. And council officers are very much involved in that approach, and that is a much more helpful way of council officers undertaking their corporate parenting role.
Any more things? I've got one more question myself.
got the next follow-up meeting with Oxford as well?
It's the 8th of August.
So who would have normally been at that meeting?
It's Fox.
Not even the lead member take part in that?
Not the first meeting.
So is there any chance of us to, for members to have the chance to meet with the inspectors or not?
Not for the 8th of August, no.
But after that?
They will be doing monitoring visits regularly, and members will, at some stage, that will be arranged, but not for the 8th of August.
Right. So you don't know that will be into the future, but you don't know when that will be arranged for?
The dates will come from Ofsted.
Can I ask Mr. Manning to give up the committee report each time when you get to Ofsted, what they have said, what have they, or what is rumours they have actually noticed, so where we are going. So it's an ongoing report every time so that we know what's going on.
Yeah, I guess
it would
be
helpful
for the further understanding of the
There will be, we will of course report that also Ofsted will publish their letters about our progress, as will the BFE.
So I have one final question for the recommendations. We've seen in the report, despite the fact that there are many areas that still require significant challenge, there are areas that have actually improved over the period leading up to the report, and more significantly from the report that was had from the verbal reports and officers today, we've actually had a number of improvements since the inspection. What evidence do we have
I will hand over to my colleagues who have been driving a number of those areas of work. It is important that we continue to drive the improvements that have been at the heart of what we've been trying to do over the last year. And I know the colleagues have been doing a lot of work, so I'll let them one after the other talk about some of the things that they're doing and how we're consolidating the improvements that we're making.
We are doing a number of things, this is very long list. One of the recommendations is to integrate early health services. So we are piloting in one of the localities, the central locality, the integrated 119 early health offer, which will bring together the schools in that area, the health services for children, health students, school nursing, and youth services, family support. And we'll bring that together as an integrated offer for all the families that live in that area. So with that pilot is going live in September, we're looking forward to that. That's been a rapid piece of work that we've undertaken. We have changed the line management of our front door, so for the MASH and for our intervention and family services. So we have some practice leaders in there now. We know what it looks like, we know how to drive improvements for children with social work in terms of decision making, oversight, scrutiny, practice and support to that. We have one of our new posts, which is it's a post around practice development, so we're leading the workforce agenda and quality assurance agenda jointly, so that we have triangulation of scrutiny, looking at what we need to improve in practice and then checking it again to make sure that it happens. That work will work alongside social workers and their team managers. It will sit with them, it will hold their hands. So there's a number of things that we've done, the 16-17 on our protocol. I've probably missed some, but there's been a number of things that we're working on very rapidly. The MASH, basically, yes, the MASH. We've introduced a daily MASH meeting where departments are meeting together on a daily basis to have discussions about some of those contacts that are coming into the service to make sure that we're sharing the right information, we're asking the right questions, and we're making the right decisions at the right level of service for those families first time. So there's a number of things happening. I'm probably not doing justice to all of them, but yeah, I think that's much all of that.
In the world called parenting, what we have done is to work on the social work practice in the front line to make sure that social workers who work long term with looked after children understand that they're also need to have a strength of intervention. So one of the things that we've done first is to create smaller teams so that there is more of management oversight of their work. We're bringing in practice development workers to look at the permanency planning so that from the moment a person, a young child, whatever age, comes into care, we are permanency planning. And that permanency plan can be return home, it can be long-term fostering, it can be adoption, it can be going to family member. But we need to be asking those questions at an earlier stage. We've strengthened the permanency planning panel, which is a decision-making panel that I chair as operational director, where there's a decision about whether a child comes into care or whether a case goes to court is made as a panel with other heads of service as well as other partner agencies around the table. We have, within the care for service, we have listened to what the young people have told us. We've met with the other stakeholders and are developing a multi-disciplinary team or multi-skilled team who can actually address the specific needs of the group of care leavers around money matters. For a care leaver, one of the biggest tensions is their how to manage their budget, how to manage their money, how to keep their tenancy. So we've listened and we've been developing services around that. We also have, we were talking about continuity earlier. We have moved the transfer age to the care service from 18 back down to 16. So the pathway planning. This pathway planning should be started, we should start at about 14 and a half, 15. But when, we're building points in the system which makes social workers think about the pathway plan earlier so that we are clear what this young person's pathway plan is long before he or she turns 18. We are strengthening the policy and the offer around stay and put. I firmly believe that if a young person is with a foster care family and we can enable that young person to stay with their family, then we need to be able to do that. So that's the work that we're doing through fostering and through the educational service. In the family centre, we are starting a project. We're talking about teaching young people how to cook. We started an independence training project where they can come to the resource centre. And some of the contact supervisors have known some of the looked after children for a long period of time. It's a familiar face because they used to supervise contact in the beginning stages of their journey in care, and they're going to be doing independence training with the looked after children. In terms of safeguarding, one of the things that we started looking at prior to the inspection, but the inspections really raised the question about the involvement of the independent reviewing officers and the child protection officers and the scrutiny that they have. So part of the work that I'm going to be doing with that team is looking at their role, making their role more of an active role alongside the social worker, not to the social worker or not to the child, but alongside. So those are all development work that we need to do. The other bit that's very clearly raised is the quality of care planning and how we write about the children and young people in their care plans. So we will have a practice development worker who will specifically work alongside all the social workers around how do we bring how do we make our care plans relevant to the child? How do we make the pathway plan something that a young person can own and call his or hers? So those are, we've started having a lot of those conversations about what that would look like and start developing, doing that development work with the social workers, because it is all dependent on the strength of the practice. And that's going to be our focus across the whole piece. Martina, I'm sure I've left something out, but there's a lot going on.
Thank you very much. I'd like to thank all the officers and all the discussion to look to support the rapid and sustained progress within the service. So with that, I'm going to move to the recommendation. So I thank those of you who have been members that any of you can not approve, so I suggest taking them on block. Are they all agreed?
Can I just check
what
you mean with the initial recommendation,
whether
it's moved to council or
is
that taken as a
well, you need to agree the recommendation or vote them down if you were going to do so before we can then refer it to council. I intend to refer it to council after the voters.
And the additional one that we actually meet.
The amended recommendation
to
6.
To Islington, so we can meet with the.
Oh, I'm happy to meet with Islington.
So we just add an additional recommendation that any of us here or yourself or myself can actually visit or visit.
Okay, if you need this recommendation, you can. I've got no problem, but I'm happy to go to Zoom with you.
Okay, well, we'll put that down.
I'll have to work out the wording for that. We can get the government to arrange appropriate wording that says that it's capital fact we're working out for Copstone or arranging visits to
Islington. So I also suggest that you maybe the only visit to Essex is their approval partner as well. So if we can arrange a visit program.
Okay.
I think it would be
nice. Should I just leave it as arranged meetings to suitable authorities?
Should we read out that recommendation to make sure that it fits what council effectively works in position?
So that the committee agreed that councillor Copeland were, and chairman arrange meeting. You wanted to specifically say Islington and Essex, or
well,
do you wanted to say
nowadays just in Essex, and we know that Islington is just but that's the two obvious ones to learn from. But I think as well as said, you would arrange for a visit along with an officer in tow as well.
I'll put to Islington and Essex.
Are you happy with that working council?
Yeah.
I'm happy with that. So if we take the amended recommendation, the other recommendations, and the additional recommendation on block, are they approved by all?
Yeah.
That's agreed. As this clearly impacts on the whole council, and since we've spoken at length about the need to make a scrutiny on this, I agree that this must be referred to the whole council, and this must go to the immediate full council, so that it can have an immediate care and be brought to the wider attention of the elected members. Is that agreed? Thank you. Thank you very much for those officers who came and able to support this.
We just make
a decision before we leave. Being heard up because it needs greater than scrutiny. It's so important. All the recommendations, including the amendments recommendation 6 and the additional recommendation 7, same in council, the paper you're going to argue with.
Yeah, I got that.
Yes. So, the next item is the education strategy.